It's really delight to see you all here because I really like meeting new people and engaging in interesting conversations. I don't know if you find this, but certainly when I meet people, it starts off with small talk, and then it gets around to that inevitable question, and what do you do? And when I say I do physics, well, it's a bit of a conversation stopper. But I'm not too worried about that tonight because, first of all, two reasons. You know that already. Is this working better? Okay, great. Okay, so I just want to say that I'm not worried about the fact that people are usually turned off by conversations if they discover I'm a physicist, because you knew that. But secondly, I'm going to be doing most of the talking. But I hope I won't do it all. And at the end, there'll be some time for questions and comments. And I hope that you'll engage with us in that conversation as we think of this topic tonight, which is the question, is it true that science has disproved God? In other words, does science show that there is no God, and therefore science leads to atheism? Now, of course, down the ages, since science was the word invented, that would be a rather strange thing for people to have said, because mostly, certainly at the very beginning, science went hand in hand with faith in a rational God who made a rational world that could be understood. But nonetheless, the danger that it might lead to atheism was recognized very early on. For example, Roger Bacon, who was a medieval philosopher who spent a lot of his time here at Oxford, recognized the danger of a first acquaintance with philosophy, or that would include science today. He said, a little philosophy inclineth man's mind to atheism, but depth in philosophy bringeth men's mind about to religion. So, what I'd like you to do is, if you forget everything else I say tonight, just keep that little saying in your mind, that depth in philosophy brings men's mind round to religion. Let me tell you roughly where we're going tonight. I want to start off by mentioning three or four things where people tend to think that science has disproved God. I'm going to look at each of those first, and then secondly, I'll think a little bit more together about the nature of science and its limits, whether in fact it can tell us whether or not God exists. And then thirdly, we'll look a little more deeply into some aspects of science that might give us some pointers into the existence of God. But I'll tell you now that I don't want you to get all excited, and that we're not going to come up tonight with a rock-solid proof that God exists, and we may end up in a position where science neither proves nor disproves God. And so fourthly, I want to consider whether or not the agnostic position is really the only honest one that we can take, and how we might deal with that issue. So let me start off by thinking together about four ideas that tend to make people think that science has disproved God. Let me tell you what they are. First of all, there's the impression that science has revealed to us the true enormity of the cosmos. People have always thought it was big, but now we know just how big it is, and that we, men, women, and children, exist on a tiny planet orbiting a pretty ordinary star in a pretty ordinary galaxy, one of 100 billion stars in that galaxy, which is itself one galaxy amongst 100 billion other galaxies. And so we're not at the center of the world or the center of the universe. We appear just like a random accident, a freak that suddenly appeared by chance on the face of the universe. And therefore, we are of no significance at all. And life has no meaning and no connection with a God. Secondly, of course, science has led us to understand the laws of nature, how it works. And when we know how things work, we know how they don't work, and they don't work by miracles. According to the laws of nature, we can predict what will happen and what won't happen. And so, in particular, the Bible comes across as being full of miracles, and because science shows that miracles can't happen, we can't really take the Bible seriously. So all this talk about God can be put to one side. And then thirdly, perhaps the most well-known objection is that based on the theory of evolution, that Darwin and his followers have shown us how life comes about by the process of natural selection acting upon random variations. And therefore, what appeared to be designed by a God can be perfectly well explained by natural processes. And so we don't need a designer or God. And then fourthly, to cap it all, even the very universe we can explain by scientific means. That it seems it can be explained as something growing out of absolutely nothing. And it created itself as a quantum fluctuation and an enormous explosion 13.5 billion years ago. And because we understand how that happens, we don't need a creator at all. So here are four reasons why it appears that science seems to have disproved God. Well, let me start with the first one. It's a good place to start. The universe is so vast that we are therefore, because we are so small and insignificant, so far from the center of anywhere, we are of no significance and life has no meaning. Now think carefully about what that is assuming. It's assuming, of course, that importance, significance, depends on your size or your position. You have to be big or at the center to be important. Now, of course, if that were true, then an elephant would be even a teeny bit more important and significant than a human being. Or that part in your small intestine here would be much more important than your brain, since it's so far away from the center. So the assumptions that they've built in, that significance depends on our position and our size, are not really logical. So this impression we have is just that. It's an emotional reaction to the vastness of space rather than a logical deduction that because we are small, we are therefore insignificant. Let's think about the second issue, that of miracles. The laws of nature tell us that miracles can happen. Well, the laws of nature have been unfolded over many years, and one of the giants of 19th century physics was Lord Kelvin, William Thomson, a very famous scientist who was responsible, amongst others, for the second law of thermodynamics that explains how everything gets more and more disordered, how the universe is running down, and so on. A very important piece of science. And did I tell you he was born in Belfast? Well, anyway, when we think about miracles, we might take a leaf out of, or learn something from what Kelvin himself said. Let's remember, first of all, what the laws of nature do. The laws of nature tell us how nature usually behaves. And scientists are very careful to make sure that when they do an experiment, they don't allow anything outside to interfere with what's going on. But supposing there were a God, and there are other reasons for believing that a God existed, then the possibility does exist, in fact, that someone might be able to interfere with what's going on from time to time. That's one possibility. What Kelvin said, for example, in 1895, was heavier than air flying machines are impossible. And if you know your history, less than 10 years later, the Wright brothers were flying heavier than air machines. So we know that the laws of nature have been broken in some way here. And of course, it wasn't by magic or by miracle. It was because what Kelvin didn't know, well, actually between you and me, he should have done, because people have been watching birds flying for many years. What he didn't know was what we now call the laws of aerodynamics. That if you have air flowing over a shaped wing like that, then the differential flows of air lead to an upthrust, a force that acts upwards that can counteract the downward force of gravity. And so here's another law of nature that allows heavier than air machines to fly. So what I want to suggest to you is that what we sometimes think of as miracles or kind of magic intervention might just be the operation of God using laws that we just don't know about. And maybe there are laws that we will never know about, but at least it's a logical possibility. John referred to the time I spent many years ago in Paris, and I had the privilege of working with a very interesting group there. And they were doing experiments, and I'm not sure I'm going to do this, this will stand here. It does, great. What they were doing was, you'd be wondering what these are all in, weren't you? This is a helium atom, and this is another one. And the group in Paris were watching helium atoms bounce off each other. That's how things collide and how it stops you, for example, falling through your seat. Because when atoms get very close, the electrical forces inside them repel. So the atoms in your bottom, sorry about that, the atoms in your bottom are sitting on the atoms of the chair, and that force between them causes them to repel, so gravity doesn't pull you through the floor. That's the law of nature, the law of electromagnetism and these electrical forces. And so what happens when helium atoms are running around? When they bump into each other, they collide. What we were able to do in those experiments was, using lasers, we could change the state of these atoms until they became perfectly identical. Now, you might thought they were identical to start with, but actually, secretly inside, there's something that wasn't quite the same. The nucleus was pointing in a random direction. So we got our lasers to make them exactly the same. And then a wonderful thing happens. Instead of colliding, they pass straight through each other. In other words, we could use the laws of quantum physics to overcome the laws of electricity. And so matter could pass through another piece of matter. Almost a miracle. Since then, groups around the world, in my own laboratory in Oxford here, there are groups making large globes of different kinds of stuff, taking ordinary atoms and changing their state until one blob of atoms can move through the other. So the reason why we have doors, of course, is that we can't walk through walls. But one of the miracles that's recorded surrounding Jesus' resurrection was in fact that he was able to come through a wall. Now, I'm not saying that's how he did it, but what I'm saying is we ought not to say just because we know a certain amount about the laws of nature that something is absolutely impossible. Just maybe God has a way, a law of nature that we don't know about, that can make things happen. Let me add also that what I'm not trying to do is to explain away miracles. What I'm trying to do is to help us open our minds to other possibilities, a different way of seeing things, if you will. Because one of the things that's often forgotten about the Bible is that it was written by the Hebrew people who had a different outlook on the world. Not at all like the Greeks, from whom we have derived much of our way of seeing things. For the Hebrews, there was no distinction between nature and supernature. They didn't have a word for supernatural in the Old Testament. Everything was in God's world, a kind of continuum. That's perhaps what St. Paul meant when he was talking to the Greeks in Athens, and he spoke about this God in whom we live and move and have our being. That there is not just the idea of a nature and a supernature, it's a foreign idea to the Hebrew people. And maybe there's something we can learn about that. And so this dislike, this distaste of miracles is based on a particular worldview that may not be correct. So let me go on to the third objection. And that was, of course, the one based on the debunking of the idea that there's a God who designs natural living things. This was an idea that gained prominence by the book by William Paley, a notable theologian in the early 18th century. And he's famous for making the analogy of finding a watch lying on the heath. and say that if you were to find a watch and examine it, you'd see by its nature, the inner workings, that it's obviously been designed. And so there must be a designer, and it was there for a purpose. But then, of course, along came Charles Darwin and said, no, we don't have to think that, because there's one general law leading to the advancement of all organic beings, and that is, namely, multiply, vary, and the strongest live and the weakest die. This was a summary of his idea of evolution by natural selection, acting upon random variations. So you could explain the varieties of life and all the intricacies and wonders of it by a purely natural process, and you didn't need a designer God. But of course, that's one way of thinking about it, but that wasn't actually the way a lot of Christians, indeed most Christians, thought about it. Their idea of a designer God wasn't one who manufactured or tinkered little bits and pieces and stuck them together. He was rather a God who might be responsible for designing the whole system. And this was put very nicely by a friend of Charles Darwin, Charles Kingsley, who was a history professor at Cambridge and a novelist, famous for the water beams, amongst other things. But a very clever man who pointed out that when he wrote to Darwin, that we knew of old that God was so wise that he could make all things. But behold, he is so much wiser than even that he can make all things make themselves. So this is a more subtle way of understanding the action of God in bringing life to change from one type into another. That he is responsible, actually, for the process, for the being of any life at all. And that what the mistake that is often made is that we confuse the mechanism with the agent. And what the theory of evolution tells us is very likely the way one life form changes into another. But it doesn't explain why there's anything there in the first place. And this was recognized many, many years ago by Thomas Aquinas, way back and about 800 years ago, when he made the observation that creation is not change. That the God that the Christians worship is the God who is responsible for there being something there in the first place. And that the job of science is to understand how the things that he has made work. To understand the mechanisms, for example, of how one species changes into another by evolution. So the fact that we have uncovered, to the best of our knowledge, a way of understanding how that happens does not at all mean that the great designer does not exist. Let me go on to the fourth one. An objection summed up here by a comment made by Carl Sagan on the theory by Stephen Hawking on the ultimate origin of the universe as a whole. Now, very briefly, the idea is here that if you were to take this room and evacuate it, everybody out, all the chairs, all the air, everything, until there's nothing left, we have a vacuum. And what we seem to know now is that even when we've done that, it still isn't empty. That there's a fluctuating vacuum there where particles appear and disappear spontaneously, and on average there's zero energy. But a little blip can happen, and suddenly there's something appears, as long as it disappears quickly again. The idea here is that 13.5 billion years ago, a fluctuation of this vacuum created the universe in a tiny ball of energy, too small to understand its size. And within a few minutes, it had grown to kilometers wide, a fiery ball of energy that continued to expand. And eventually, that energy condensed into stars and galaxies and planets and people like you and me. And it all came from this random chance event in a fluctuating nothing. So we all came out of nothing. That's apparently the scientific theory which does away with the creator. And it's caught on in a lot of places. People are starting actually to believe this. And I have to say, even some scientists believe it, although they should know better. But of course, what I've just described to you as nothing isn't what you and I mean by nothing. It's not what nothing is in the philosophical sense or the common sense of nothing. Nothing means no thing. It doesn't mean a quantum field that can fluctuate and then be acted upon by the laws of gravity. Where did they come from? You see the problem? What that doesn't explain is why there's something rather than nothing. A question put by Leibniz, who lived around the time of Isaac Newton. So what he's saying is that it is existence which the Creator brings into being. It's not the mechanism, and we mustn't confuse that. So God is, if you like, the ultimate explanation as to why there is something rather than nothing. And the idea that the universe out of nothing explains things doesn't really. You still have to account for the laws of gravity and the laws of quantum physics that allow that process to happen at all. So let's move on. We've seen that the idea that the universe doesn't need a creator doesn't solve the problem, because we still need something to explain why there's something rather than nothing. Now, one of the other interesting things was that it turned out that this idea that the universe, space and time was created in that Big Bang was preempted, let me work it out, about 1600 years ago. Much to the annoyance of theoretical physicists, Augustine had written many years ago in the 4th century that God had made time as well. And here's us thinking we had discovered that time had come into being itself at the Big Bang, so that before that there wasn't any such thing as time. That's exactly what Augustine was saying. That existence of both time and space is the result of the Creator's action. So now it's time to have a look at the nature of science and to discover a little bit about its limitations, to see whether in fact it can give us definite answers to the existence of God. Now I'm looking around the room here and I can tell that there are some people here who remember this comedy duo from the 50s and 60s, George Burns and Gracie Allen. I used to love them. And you may remember that after their show, and if you haven't seen this, if you're not old enough to remember this, YouTube, look it up and you'll find them. After their show, George and Gracie would come out onto the stage, a bit like this one, and stand in front of the curtain, and they'd have a little conversation. I remember one very well, and Gracie comes out and she says to George, "My nephew is doing some scientific research." And George turns to her and says, "That's very interesting, Gracie. What's he researching into?" And Gracie says, "Well, he's trying to find out how many people in California have a telephone." This was 1950s. And so George puffs on a cigar and says, "Well, Gracie, what did he find?" "George, it was 100%. Everyone he called up had one." Now, of course, when scientists do a piece of research, they're always very careful not to prejudice the results, to make sure that they don't build into the way they're doing the experiment the result that they're going to get. But of course, the very essence of science is that we're trying to make explanations of how one thing works in terms of another. We use the scientific method, use experimental methods that was invented by Roger Bacon that we met at the very beginning. And what we do is we try to find natural explanations by doing experiments. But of course, that will only allow us to find out what can be discovered by those methods. So we use what's called methodological naturalism. Sorry for those big words. What it means is we just use natural means to explain what's going on. But that doesn't mean that that's all that could be going on. It just means that that's all that the scientific method can discover. That there are certain things built into the nature of science that will limit what it can find out. So this was put very well by another Oxford philosopher, Elizabeth Anscombe, who said that this often happens in philosophy. It's argued that all we find is such and such, and it turns out that the arguer has excluded from this idea of finding the sort of things he says we don't find. So, of course, if science purports to tell us that it has found that God does not exist, it's because it started off with that assumption that he's not interfering with our experiments, and so by definition, he will not be found as a result of it. So the non-existence, for practical purposes, of God is not a finding of science, it's an assumption of science. And it's as well to bear that in mind, and that's a fundamental limitation of the scientific method. So let's look a bit further into the nature of science and what it can do and how it works. Probably the most powerful method that it uses is to reduce the problem to simpler elements. We start off with something complicated and we break it down into smaller bits until we get smaller and smaller until eventually we're down to atoms. And we explain everything in terms of those smaller bits. It's the method of reductionism, reducing everything to simpler parts. Now what we have to be aware of course is that if we then use that method to explain absolutely everything, which some of our new atheist friends would like to do, in other words to say that at the end of the day there's nothing, sorry, my wife keeps talking to me. Am I speaking too loudly? Okay, great. So we were talking about the method that science uses to explain things by reducing them to smaller and smaller bits. And the result that they sometimes come up with is that we can reduce everything to the laws of physics. Well, I like that, okay? That's my territory. So if we're going to explain everything just by the action of atoms and molecules, then of course that will explain our very act of thinking about them. So think a bit for a little bit what that means. It means that even our thinking can be reduced to just the motion of atoms. And if your thinking is going to be true and valid, it has to follow a train of thought. If A then B, if B then C, if C then D, and each step must be logical and rational. If we get to a point where we make an irrational step, like if C then D, because he was hungry then, and that has nothing to do with the argument, that's an irrational step. And then the argument is then spoiled. We can't trust the conclusion if we use an illogical, irrational step in the argument. But if you go all the way back, take everything all the way back, and you end up with just the motion of atoms bumping off each other, that is not a rational process. So that means all of our thinking is based on an irrational process. Now this was recognized by the famous evolutionary biologist J.B.S. Holbein, who was an atheist, mind you, and he wrote this. If my mental processes are determined wholly by the motions of atoms in my brain, I have no reason to suppose my beliefs are true, and hence I have no reason to suppose my brain to be composed of atoms. In other words, he recognized that this reductionist, materialist argument was sawing off the logical branch that he or she was sitting on. It was, if you like, a proof that there are no proofs. Now this is a problem that goes way back. I think it was recognized probably by Aristotle also, because he quoted a proverb to the effect that if a man chokes on water, with what will he wash it down? So if we can't trust our reason, how can we trust any of its conclusions? And if our reason is in doubt, then you can't use reason to justify it or validate it. You're in a real problem. So there's something clearly wrong with this purely naturalistic, materialistic account of nature. There must be something more. C.S. Lewis, another Oxford man, put it this way: unless our reason is valid, no science is possible. In other words, we can't say anything about nature, about the laws of nature, unless we trust our reason. And so our reason, our rationality, must make some connection with something beyond us that validates our rationality. And it must be more than just atoms and molecules. It must be something more than reason. The French physicist and philosopher Blaise Pascal put it beautifully. He said this: that the supreme function of reason is to show man that there are some things beyond reason. So we're beginning, as we get a bit deeper into philosophy, to see things pointing in a certain direction. So let's thirdly turn to what I promised, and that is to look a little bit about some of the things we might learn from science about whether or not God might exist. And the thing that every scientist is impressed with, to some degree or other, when he gets into the subject, is the overwhelming sense of order in nature. And that's actually, in a sense, rather surprising, because mostly when we look around, we see things rather random and higgledy-piggledy. We know the sun comes up every day, but we're never sure what the weather's going to be like. That nature often seems random, and accidents happen, and life seems unpredictable. And the unpredictability of nature was often put down by primitive religions to the actions of capricious gods, out of control of human beings. And it was an insight that came from the Christian tradition of the biblical way of thinking about the world, that this world was made by a rational creator and could therefore show signs of that rational order that motivated the growth of science in Christian cultures. Of course, there are other influences from Islam and Greeks, of course. But things really took off when people began to experiment following Bacon and to think rationally, to find the laws of nature that they believed were there, even in spite of appearances. And of course, what we see, the more we dig into nature, is that it's ordered all the way down. I don't know if you've seen that taxi running around Oxford. It has the periodic table of the elements on it. It may remind you of those horrible days in chemistry at school. But you may remember also that people used to categorize the atoms and the elements in different ways, perhaps by lumping together those that smelled the same or behaved in certain ways the same. And it wasn't until eventually it dawned on people that there was an underlying order, that we went from hydrogen to helium to lithium and so on by adding one more proton, all the way up from 1 to 92 we get to uranium, and there's a deep sense of order in the structure of everything that the world is made up of. And it's just beautiful. It's a simplifying order structure, and that idea of order is all the way through nature. And that speaks to us of minds, of an organizing principle, a rational principle, that we call a mind. And we see it over and over again in nature. Perhaps no more spectacularly is that true in what's come to be known as the fine-tuning of the universe. We've spoken a little bit about the Big Bang and how the universe came into being. And if you know a little bit about it, you know that to begin with, the only atoms that existed were hydrogen, and they clumped together by gravity to make stars like our own sun, burning hydrogen away there. And hydrogen burned by one hydrogen atom bumping into another and sticking to making a helium atom. And then the helium would burn slowly, and eventually, if nothing else happens, the star would go out. But of course, the universe is made up of more than just hydrogen and helium. We have all these heavier elements that turned out to be burned up in the core of certain types of stars. In order to get that process going, and certainly to have you and me here, we need a lot of carbon. Now, carbon consists of three helium nuclei stuck together. Now, it turns out when you do the sums, that's very difficult to do. If you just let the atoms rattle around, the chances of three of them hitting together and making carbon are astronomically small. It wouldn't explain the amount of carbon we have in the universe. And this struck an atheist astronomer and physicist, Fred Hoyle, as being very peculiar, because clearly there was a lot of carbon about. Here we are using it to think, where did it come from? And he figured out that there must be what we call in the trade a resonance, something that arises because of the strength of the forces being just right, so that when three atoms come together, the probabilities increase significantly that they'll stick. And this was very unexpected, and no one knew that that would be possible. But Fred Hoyle said it must be happening, and so they started to look for it. And you know what? They found it. This resonance, just where it's supposed to be. And this struck Hoyle as being very peculiar. And he said this: a common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect has monkeyed with the physics. The numbers one calculates from the facts seem to me so overwhelming as to put this conclusion almost beyond question. That's just one of those so-called cosmic coincidences that struck an atheist as being very peculiar and seemed to point to a mind behind the universe. Now, I don't think it ever totally convinced Fred Hoyle, and he retained his atheism. But nonetheless, the coincidence didn't stop there. And I could talk for actually quite a long time about these, but I won't. I'll just tell you one more. You're aware of the fact that we live in a universe which is expanding. That space and time itself is expanding. And it's expanding at just the right rate to allow us to be here. If the constant of nature that governed the rate of expansion had been a little bit different, then the universe would have collapsed on itself a long time ago. If it had been a little bit faster, then the galaxies would never have formed because the acceleration would be too big. Einstein came up with the idea that you could explain this by a cosmological constant that you could set to receive just the right rate of expansion to allow the universe to exist in its present form. And that constant has to have a very precise value. Now let me say what I mean by precision. My height is 1.8 meters, roughly. If I want to be more precise, I'll say it's 1.82 meters. In other words, I can measure to 2 millimeters in a meter. So that's one part in 100. That's what I call precise. If you want to get it even more precise, you can measure to a nanometer, or one part in a one with 9 zeros after it, a billion, okay? So the bigger that number, the more precisely you're measuring something. Well, how precise does this constant of nature have to be to get the universe we're now in? Well, it turns out that this cosmological constant has to be specified to a precision of 1 part in 10 to the 40. Now, let me tell you what that means. That's 1 with 40 zeros after it. 1 in, well, I don't know how many billion gazillions that is, but it's a big number. That is awfully precise. If it had been a little bit different, we wouldn't be here. That's another pointer to our existence being far from insignificant. We live in a very special universe, a universe that's not just ordered, but precisely constructed. And another, let me mention another Oxford mathematician and philosopher, Roger Penrose, who's done some of these calculations, and some of them are even more astounding than this one. But he said, I would say the universe has a purpose. It's not just there somehow by chance. So these pointers that we find in the scientific investigation of nature seem to point towards the existence of a mind behind it. Now, of course, it doesn't totally prove it. There are other ways that it could be explained. One of the most popular ones is the idea of a multiverse. In other words, that we're in one universe, but there might be more, and we just happen to be in one, where all these constants just happen to come up. Now, of course, think a little bit about that. What's the chances of you winning the lottery? It's about 1 in 14 million. You're going to change the rules, so it's going to go up to 1 in 45 million. Okay. What are the chances of you winning it 2 weeks in a row? Well, you have to multiply those two numbers together. So the chances get even smaller. So every time you've got an unlikely event and multiply it by another unlikely event, and you need both of them, then the chances get even smaller. Now, of course, all these constants of nature, as far as we know, are independent. And so the probability of them all coming up with that kind of probability is surely beyond chance. But it could be, it has to be said, explained by a multiverse, that there are millions, gazillions, perhaps an infinite number of other universes, and we just happen to be in the one where all these numbers came up. In all the other ones, perhaps most of them, the numbers are slightly different, and we never get life. They're completely sterile. But of course, we're now treading beyond science, because as we know, science is what we can study and investigate and detect. And if these multiverses are what they're said to be, then we can have no contact with them and can't detect their presence. And so, in a sense, it's not science if we can't observe them. If we could observe them, if there was some way in which they had some influence on this present universe, if they were causally connected in some way, then of course they become part of our universe, the one we can experience. So the multiverse idea, although logically possible, seems to me to be, and to many scientists, rather implausible. There's certainly no way we can ever check it. By its very nature, it's impossible to be checked. So what we've seen is that when we look scientifically at the world around us, we see it imbued with order. We see it with pointers towards a supreme intellect. And we see expressions of mind all the way through. We have discovered what appear to be laws of nature. And the implication, of course, then is, if there are laws, could there not be a lawgiver? You see, one of the most staggering things about the universe is that we can understand it at all. That it isn't totally capricious and random. And Einstein put it this way. He said, the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible. In other words, there's something about it that our minds are able to grasp. And that seems more than just a coincidence. But if there are these laws that help us to understand it, it suggests there's a lawgiver. Now, the other thing that we're able to do as scientists is to be very precise about how we describe these laws. And we use mathematics. Don't worry, I'm not going to use any tonight. But it's a remarkable thing that mathematics works so well. There are many instances of people doing pure mathematics and then finding to their surprise that actually the real world was like that after all. In the 1930s, an English physicist called Paul Dirac did some very beautiful pieces of mathematics where he predicted the existence of antiparticles. We have an electron or a proton, and according to his equations, there should be anti-electrons and anti-protons. No one had ever seen them, but the mathematics said they were there, And you know what? They were. When they went looking for them, they found them, and mathematics had predicted it. That was staggering. Mathematics seems extraordinarily good at allowing us to describe nature. So good, in fact, that it struck another theoretical physicist, Eugene Wigner, as such, that the enormous usefulness of mathematics in the physical sciences is something bordering on the mysterious, and there's no rational explanation for it. And he went further. He said the miracle of the appropriateness of the language in mathematics for the formulation of the laws of physics is a wonderful gift which we neither understand nor deserve. And gifts suggest a giver. I've mentioned quite a few physicists in my talk so far, but none of them I've ever met personally except the next one. I had the privilege of meeting Arthur Shallow, who won the Nobel Prize for the invention of the measure that led to the laser. He worked in London at the time I was there for a while, and he's a lovely man. And he too was struck by the pointers in nature that science was able to discover. And he said this: "It seems to me that when confronted with the marvels of life and the universe, one must ask why and not just how. The only possible answers are religious. I find the need for God in the universe and in my own life." Well, of course, everything that I've said are really just pointers. I can't present you with 100% proof that God exists. But what I hope I show you tonight is that certainly science does not disprove the existence of God. And in fact, there are many pointers to the existence of the supreme being behind the universe. But if there's no 100% proof, does that not mean that surely all we can do is be agnostic, to say we'll never really know? And of course, that's a position that many people will take. But I want to ask whether that is necessarily the only position, or even the wisest position that we should take in a matter such as the existence of God. And I want to suggest two reasons why we might get past agnosticism. The first one is to realize, of course, that some questions we're wise to be agnostic about. I think the importance of the question is underlined by C.S. Lewis again, who said that Christianity, if false, is of no importance, and if true, of infinite importance. The only thing it cannot be is moderately important. The question is just too important to shrug our shoulders and say, we don't know or we can't know. But how do we go further? I think that what we've been looking at so far have been scientific pointers and evidences, but of course, we've seen that science is limited to those things it can study by its methods. But maybe that's not the only source of evidence that we can find. Maybe there are other evidences. Let me suggest four very briefly. The first one is the almost universal sense of right and wrong. Our conscience, our ideas of goodness, truth, justice, love, compassion, that are shared by all cultures to greater or less degree. Where did that come from? Now, of course, evolutionary biologists would want to explain it simply as the result of evolutionary processes, a survival strategy that guarantees our existence. It helps us survive if we're moral. So in other words, we can reduce our morality to the operation of our genes or some system biology. Eventually we get down to atoms and molecules again. And atoms and molecules are just there. They're not right or wrong, true or false. They just are. Morality speaks to us of values, of goodness, truth, and beauty. More than just what is. If you reduce something to what is, then the idea of morality disappears. Just as we saw when rationality was reduced to atoms and molecules, it disappeared. Similarly, morality will disappear if we try to explain it away simply on the basis of a mechanism by which it might have come around. So this sense of morality, we have an idea that some morals are better than others, suggests to us that there's an absolute standard that we can compare them with. If your idea of Boston is better than mine, it's because there's a real Boston we could go and compare it to. There's an absolute standard of right and wrong, goodness, truth and beauty to which we can refer, and that's God. Secondly, there's historical evidence, and I speak particularly of the biblical evidence for Jesus, of his life, his death and his resurrection. We've already said that we must not simply discount written evidence that something strange has happened because we decided in principle that it can't happen. We want to look instead at the historical evidence of whether it did in fact happen. And there is good historical evidence that Jesus did live, he taught, he died, and he rose again. And there's some books on the bookstall I could recommend to you that will look at some of those details in some depth. But that evidence can't just be dismissed. It's there, and it needs to be taken seriously. And then, of course, there's the historical experience of God for men and women all down the ages in different cultures. And in particular, the experience of God that we have recorded in the Bible, men and women of faith who have experienced God in a very real way and recorded their experiences for us to learn by. This is evidence too, and mustn't just be discounted because we think in principle it can't be reliable. Human lives have been changed by interacting with God. People's lives have been turned around and quite literally saved by putting their faith in God. That's an experience that has to be taken on board as evidence that God exists. And then finally, and this is even more briefly, I can tell you my own personal experience that I experience God in my life day by day. I know that when I turn away from him, it changes the way I live. It's an experiment that I can do, and I find God to be real, just as Arthur Shiloh discovered God to be real in his life. Now, of course, that won't be a proof to you. You would have to experience that for yourself in order for it to be a proof. But it wouldn't really be a proof. It would be something that gave you confidence that your faith was well-founded. Because it's possible, at the end of the day, to put all of these things down to coincidence. But I'd like to just make one last quotation from Einstein. He said that coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. Why would he do that? But of course, you think of Jesus in his life. He didn't just do miracles to order. He was very sparing with his acts of power because he did not want to overpower people, to force them into belief. And in the same way, God wants to leave us room to make a freely chosen decision whether to accept him and to worship him. Not just to decide whether he exists or not. He wants a relationship with us. And that kind of relationship requires faith and not a forced assent. So that's the possible reason why we're left without 100% proof. So I want to finish by just winding things up a little bit. It seems to me that we can look at the universe around us and the wonders of nature and think of it as God's way of catching our attention. Imagine we're at a party and in a big room like this, and into the room comes a stunningly beautiful woman or a very tall, handsome man. And of course, you make your way across the room, not being too obvious. I should say I've been married now for over 40 years, And so it's a long time since I did this, but you know the idea. Try to get close to this person and engage them in conversation. And of course, at first, it's kind of small talk, this and that. And as the small talk goes on, you're looking for little signs that this person is worth getting to know, more than just a pretty face, as it were. But the small talk won't get you there. You're waiting for them to reveal something of themselves so that you'll get to know them a little bit better. And maybe science and the study of the universe is like our small talk with God. He's caught our attention and we can engage in conversation in that way. But it'll only take us so far unless he reveals something of himself to us. And I think it's a nice way to think of the Bible as a conversation between humanity and God, in which God reveals himself slowly at first, progressively. Initially they make mistakes, they misunderstand, and it doesn't seem consistent. But eventually they get a fuller picture, ultimately when God takes the form of a man himself in Jesus Christ. And that's as much as he can give us without totally overpowering us. And then to get beyond that, to get that certainty that overcomes our doubts, we need to make a step of faith. I've been married, as I said, for over 40 years, and I'm still learning about my wife. I thought I knew her. We were going out for some time. I won't bore you with the details, but after 5 or 6 years, I eventually proposed. And I began only then to discover the true woman that she was. And it's been a delight. But I would never have found that out had I not made that commitment of faith. And so what I'm suggesting is the small talk of science will take us only so far. And the Bible will tell us something about God's revelation to us. But to really know him, then we've got to make that extra step, that justified step of belief. And then I can assure you that you will begin to experience him in a way in which you find a love, a joy, and a peace which passes understanding. Thank you very much.